On Saturday, the 18th of March, a visiting UK TERF figurehead named Kelly J. Keane, or Posie Parker, came to Melbourne as part of a tour she's been doing around Australia. A gathering of her TERF supporters showed up to see her, and a coalition of trans rights activists and anti-fascists showed up to counter them. And then a self-described attendant vanguard of neo-Nazis showed up too. And since then, there's been a lot of interest in the whole thing and a fair bit of fallout. And all of that is what I'm discussing in this lengthy YouTube video by Ton Tanaki. Look, sometimes expertise takes time, okay? NSN leader Tom Sewell and a group of about 15 to 20 young men and or boys from the National Socialist Network attended Posie Parker's TERF event. They marched around and they stood on the Parliament steps. They sighailed a lot. They were given ample space to do so by the Victoria Police, and then they were escorted back out again. They had two intentions on that day. One was recruitment and the other was to support the rally. Firstly, regarding their recruitment. Since everyone's interested in these guys at the moment, I'm going to give you a brief history of who they are and how they find new little boys to join their group. Tom Sewell was a leading organiser of the United Patriots Front, which was one of the main groups of the mid-2010s Patriot movement. Back then, they all used to hide their Nazi feelings behind a veneer of anti-Islam, civic nationalism, something the mainstream media fell for, hook, line and sinker. It took anti-fascists like Slackbastard to have to point out that this was all bullshit. Sewell often gloats that at its peak, the UPF Facebook page had more video views than the mainstream telly's evening news was getting at that time. And he's right. But through a combination of concerted anti-fascist resistance and Facebook page bans, the Patriot movement crumbled in around mid-2017. Sewell went on to organise groups that more accurately reflected his neo-Nazi politics, culminating in this current one, the NSN, which just straight up publicly sighails and reveres Hitler and so on. He's been at this a long time, is what I'm saying, and as such, he's an old hand at getting attention for recruitment purposes. So what is his recruitment strategy? It is to carry out non-violent stunts that attract interest from upset little white boys who are attracted to mainstream Australian media coverage of his group, which portrays them as big tough villains. As long as they can just remain non-violent and conduct those stunts legally, then they can continue to recruit without any, you know, punishment or the like, until they have so many people on board, this is the plan anyway, that it's not possible for state intelligence to shut them down really ruthlessly. Like, the idea is that if NSN had 1,000 members, then ASIO obviously must have to tread a little more lightly than if they only had 100. So that's the plan. This is a stunt-based, promotion-based, neo-Nazi public recruitment model of operation, which has a history dating back to the birth of modern neo-Nazis, like right back to the 1950s and 60s when the American Nazi Party first pioneered doing provocative pro-Hitler stunts to leverage the press for promo, just to nab that little wedge of angry white dudes. So you recall NSN's Grampians bushwalk back in 2021. That's when they first went public with this strategy. The non-violent recruitment strategy was actually doing great for them. They were getting all the press in the world and they were getting lots of interest, until Tom Sewell sabotaged it by being violent. He physically assaulted some people and he sank his own group's efforts in legal strife due to his inability to control his own temper. But now it's 2023, he's partly in the clear from all those legal dramas and he's back to the same strategy again, except for now, unlike 2021, there's all these Melbourne rallies that he can do it at. They are actually the perfect place for this strategy because they're always policed by 700,000 armoured riot cops, so nobody even really gets a chance to be violent with each other. On that note, Sewell keeps saying that they didn't need that police protection to save them from any fight because they're all really tough. And I mean, great, yay for them, And he's right, actually. The counter-protesters on the day totally didn't want that fight. But that's not really the point. I'm saying NSN needed police protection to save their own group from being inundated in a new wave of charges. And in fact, that's exactly why Sewell took them out there, because he knew they'd have a vanguard of cops to protect their vanguard from getting bogged down in more legal stuff. Does that make sense? Like, NSN needed the cops for their specific recruitment strategy to work. So take Saturday as a sign that Tom Sewell is hoping to receive fresh applications from upset teenage white boys to join his group. Like, he's looking for fresh young boy meat. The other reason that I said he was rocking up was to support the rally. Often, when I go to rallies, it's because I agree with the stuff that they're saying. Like, if I go to an event, then I go to it. If I like it and if I agree with something, I just agree with it. And then if I don't, do you like my take on this? Is there a certain intuitive elegance to it, isn't there? You know, I feel compelled to have to state the bleeding fucking obvious here, because there's a lot of TERF chatter I see about why this is not so simple.
I don't think it's beyond the wit of anyone to think that that either was TRAs dressed up or police, or just something was just off.
There wasn't enough violence between the two men.
Best case scenario was a massive mistake by the police to let these unidentifiable masked men in, because all of us women were terrified.
I'm saying it is simple. It is elegantly simple. NSN went in support of that event. They described themselves as a vanguard for them. They said they went in support. They said the women at the rally loved them. And they said they were protecting the TERFs from communists. Let's also not forget that this isn't their first rodeo. A lot of people don't seem to be talking about this. They've been targeting queer events for months. Last year in October, they targeted a young drag performer named Belial Bazaar by approaching their event, and this is a young event for young people, with a banner about pedophilia and shit, just like they did on Saturday. And just like on Saturday, we were also serviced at that time last year by some very friendly Victorian police officers. So they're experienced at attacking the queer community. It makes sense that they would show up to another rally geared around attacking the queer community, wouldn't it? Yes, yes, it would. But I've been hearing another take. And this take is that it's actually my fault that Nazis went there on Saturday. It's interesting, isn't it? Let's have a chat about that.
We want our female-only spaces back!
Okay, so there's a prominent local TERF. For the uninitiated, if there's any at this stage, that's trans-exclusionary radical feminist. And her name is Angela Jones. Angela tweeted on Monday that she'd previously contacted me and Slackbastard in late December 2022, being that we're prominent local anti-fascists, I guess, to ask for our help keeping Nazis away from her event. And I think the idea for Angela is that this showing this now proves that she didn't really want Nazis at her event, and that that exonerates her from any discomfort she's been made to feel for standing alongside them. And I think she's also trying to say that it is therefore my fault that Nazis came to her event, because I didn't do as I was told with her DM. Now, I won't leave Angela hanging, because I am a truth-telling, biological adult human male. So while I can't speak for Slackbastard, who, as I understand it, said, you know, I got the bloody message, I am happy to confirm that Angela Jones did send me this message. Here's my screenshot of it just to prove it, okay? And what she said was, I need help. I need help keeping fascist scum out of women's rights protests. We don't want them there, but we are mostly middle-aged and older women, lesbians, old-school feminists who have no means to keep them away. I still have that message. I need help. I still have that same message because at the time I shared it into this little Telegram chat I share with, you know, researcher mates, anti-fascist comrades and so on and so forth. And I thought it was funny looking back because I can also show you the three observations I made at the time when I shared the screenshots with my comrades. Here they are. The first thing I said at the time was, and I quote, I need help keeping people who agree with me away from me. Yeah, Angela wanted me to save her from the optics of having bad people who agree with her rock up because she didn't want to suffer the reputational damage of having to hang out with them on camera. She was never at risk from these people who agree with her because, like we've established, they came to support her. Remember, their main aim was actually to protect her from people like me. She just didn't like the optics of that happening. She was uncomfortable with that, so she tasked me with laundering her reputation. The second thing I said to my comrades on the 3rd of January when I uncovered that message request was, don't fucking act like you don't know me, you weird cunt, because I have met Angela Jones before. And we haven't spoken for years, and I just think if you haven't spoken to someone for ages, but you've met them in a real meat space, it's a bit weird and performative to open with, I need help with, like in normal human being speak, you might go, oh, g'day, long time no see. Remember the person that you knew once? It's just sus, and it made me wonder if Angela was perhaps a little bit more interested in doing a little performance for screenshot purposes than actually talking to me as a human, you know what I mean? Now, how did I meet Angela Jones before? Let me tell you, she was once a follower of some of my ye old anti-fascist satirical efforts from way back in 2016, 2017, back when I was doing Million Flag Patriots, which was my attempts to combat groups like Tom Sewell's United Patriots Front by taking the piss. All of it ancient history, though. This is many years ago. We drifted apart in 2017, and yeah, I guess years later, I saw she'd blossomed into a big old TERF and a chronic Twitter user. Many of the people you encounter in fringe political subcultures, like the one that I've been a part of for many years, are kind of just lonely people looking for a friend or looking for a way to feel loved and important and validated. Often, for that kind of person, the politics are they're almost immaterial. Because it's not actually politics or social justice that they're even looking for. What they're looking for is friends. The danger with these drifters is that if you ever critique them about something, you have to watch out, because if the really needy ones feel like the love tap's been turned off, they can go and do some really silly shit. And these are the kinds of people, the really needy ones, who actually change their politics like how kids switch football teams. The thing is that scenes like the far right and, yes, TERF spaces are really great at nabbing up loners and drifters, particularly ones who feel spurned by the left for some reason. There's this old adage that comes to mind about how the left seeks to exclude on a mission to include, whereas the right seeks to include on a mission to exclude. And I think that's always been very telling to me of the worst tendencies of both scenes. Here's an interesting case in point on that note. Angela isn't even the only drifter at that rally who used to be my little friend. You see, I noticed her in this footage. This is a woman at Angela and Kelly's TERF rally, and her name's Felicity Sharp. Felicity is the absolute textbook definition of switching football teams. In the time I've known of Felicity's existence, she has adopted the personas of, and this is not an exclusive list, a Russian Nazbol, an anti-fascist, a fascist, a sort of mainstream representational girl boss feminist type, a communist, a centre-left Labour stan, a Christian fundamentalist, and actually, for a little while, a kind of a hanger-on to me. Here she is in 2019. Look at these messages. Hey, hey, wanna go for a coffee? Wanna be my comrade? Are we comrades? Hey, hey, let's go for a coffee. Hey, 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 Tom, hey. Apart from a brief period of trying to go out for a coffee a lot with me in 2019, for most of the past 10 years, she's been a self-avowed anti-Semite Nazi. So I think Felicity's worth mentioning for two reasons. One is that she's a Nazi who was actually there in the rally, so this kind of undermines any TERF argument that at the moment that the only Nazis were that kind of small group of men in all black with masks on, Sieg hailing and stuff. Because actually, mate, one of them was behind you at the rally wearing a biological adult human female shirt. Thanks to Real Rooksham for collecting this footage, by the way. Thank you for documenting Melbourne's neo-Nazi problem, rookies. The other reason I bring Felicity up is to say that just like her and her biannual political orientation shifts, I don't take Angela Jones's TERF politics legitimately as the politics of someone who genuinely engages in politics. I know they have a genuine impact on trans people's safety, but what I mean is that I take them as the politics of someone who got snapped up by some cooked TERF love bomber in 2018 when she was feeling like a lonely and sad, isolated mum. And that's basically what I said here in this December tweet I did. And yeah, for the record, I kind of actually was picturing Angela when I said that one of the two kinds of TERF seems to be a sad mum. And at that time, Angela responded to me, wouldn't you know it, by saying, and I quote, "Want to tell us about why you support male rapists being sent to women's jails or support blah, 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 another faux leftist MRA shilling for the gov and big pharma?" And you know what's remarkable about that to this faux leftist MRA? That just a couple of weeks after she said that, she decided to task me to give me the honour of saving her reputation from Nazis. What an honour that I rose in Angela Jones's estimation so much in just two short weeks. Here's the third thing I said on the 3rd of January in my little comrade chat about Angela Jones's message to me. I said, "Sure, let me leap to your assistance with fascists as you continue to use your socials to pass on more possible counter options to fascists." Because, hey, I have seen on many occasions how Angela Jones's shares of drag events on Twitter, calling them all pedos and shit, would get shuttled into far-right Telegram spaces and then they get optioned as possible disruption targets. And then I would do something about that, and I did for months, with little resources available to me as part of a collective, but, you know, basically just an interstate anti-fascist hermit fucking video guy. And I'd invariably do that in private so as to not stoke further tensions or, you know, paint a bigger target on those queer community events just in case no assholes did rock up. Last year, I got a bunch of young queer people together at a private event in Melbourne. I won't go into further details. It's not, you know, it's not for the likes of the public. To run them all through the basics of protecting their digital privacy just so that they are less likely to be stalked and attacked by all the evil meddling cunts who follow people like Angela Jones. And I helped coordinate small groups of people for numerous private counters, which was invariably just in case. We had people standing by, just in case. I did that during many midsummer events. I worked as part of collectives doing that before midsummer. I did a lot of that. And it's been a lot. So tell me this, why would I, after I spent month after fucking month privately organising to protect queer youth community events, help some evil, sad old meddler in her quest to continue to endanger those same queer kids? Tell me that. Because after all that effort, Angela Jones, I am the one who needs help. I need help, Angela. I need help with protecting events for young queers from assholes like you. Who's going to help me, you fucking moron? Oh no, the bearded male MRA misogynist is abusing women again. Look at how they talk to you. Here we go. "Tom Tanicky has a classic sex offender mentality. He mocks the experiences and subsequent fears women and girls live with as pornified fantasies. He get off on female trauma.
He gets off on psychologically torturing and degrading women who have every reason to fear men.
These comments actually leave me fucking breathless with how gross and gratuitous and foully worded they are. And their words are debilitating to read, you know, because of how graphic they are. When you get 7,000 of these comments after mildly objecting or talking shit on Twitter, it's debilitating. And it's actually meant to be.
Why do you stand with Nazis, though?
Why don't you go away?
So I think TERFs, as gender essentialists, are very transfixed by identity politics. I mean, they all kind of have to be, really, given the hill they've chosen to die on. So I find they always have a really good label to deploy to kind of eliminate people from a discussion. So as I'm a cishet bloke who is a comrade to trans people, I'm recast as a misogynist, a bearded male MRA sexual offender, a misogynist woman hater who won't hashtag let women speak. But if I were queer, for example, or a woman, I would be labelled a homophobe because apparently then I'd be letting trans people groom gay or lesbian people into being trans. This is their little conspiracy theory. Everyone has a debilitating label that can take them out of the discussion because TERF politics is weaponized identity politics, you know. Now, I'm an old lefty warhorse with many years of activism and being part of collectives under my belt. So I've been through the era of representational and visibility politics. So, for example, in the discussion about trans liberation, obviously, we want trans people to have a starring role if they want it and can handle it. I mean, you don't want a fucking conversation where everyone else speaks for trans people. This entire gender ideology culture war battle in the mainstream media space is the regressive result of never including trans people's perspectives, isn't it? So I have the impulse of not wanting to be the starring cishet white knight hero figure in all of the many running battles I've fought over the years. Consequently, I don't like to be called the bearded male MRA misogynist sex offender. I mean, who would, right? You know, you don't get a thrill when you read that. When I am called that, it stirs my kind of representational politics impulse desire to want to shut the fuck up and step back. And it's very nice of me to have that impulse. Well done, Tom. But it's also the point of the insult. These TERFs, they want everyone else shutting up and stepping back and leaving the roughly 1% of the population that make up trans people on their fucking own. Now, I believe in solidarity politics, and I believe in trans liberation, but I don't think trans people can get there on their own. That's not a vote of no confidence in them for me. It's just a numbers game. It's a calculation. Liberation of any kind is only possible if enough of us band together for it, and roughly 1% of any population, it ain't enough. Needs more people, and so it should. As someone who wants to be a useful comrade to trans people against, you know, people like TERFs, I can definitely put my time to better use than, you know, endless spiteful running Twitter battles with people calling me names all day. But I should still definitely stick my neck out, despite the fear of being labelled a bearded adult human biological male bearded MRA classic sex offender bearded man. And I'm bringing all this up to encourage the same boldness among many of you, like, you know, all my comrades who aren't trans. Show some spine, show some solidarity, and stick your fucking neck out and go boots on ground if you can. If you don't want to be the white knight figure, that's great. Just be nuanced in the way that you approach your solidarity. For example, you know, you probably know, if you know me, about my history with Yard yelling at racist dogs, but I wouldn't go and deploy my old Yard-style tactics bellowing at TERFs at these events, because I know what kind of optics that would create, and I'm not exactly going to be very useful as a comrade here if I just provide the opponents of my trans comrades with free angry bearded male MRA misogynist video content, would I? You know, that is not useful to their struggle or mine, therefore. But we should all be involved in some way because anti-fascism is anti-TERF. So I think it's very useful for non-trans comrades like myself to start out reading good work like, for example, The Transgender Issue by Sean Fay. That is a great book. I loved it so much. I think it made me think a lot smarter about all this stuff. And I think I'm probably a better comrade to my trans pals because of it. There you go. There's a book reco that you can go and read in case you have any silly questions. What Nazis like about TERFs is that they both hate trans people. Now, I get that figures like Posie Parker or way up the top of the TERF food chain, the really respectable figures like J.K. Rowling, I get that they don't peddle the outright brutal anti-trans violent sentiment or, you know, like vindictive stuff quite so boldly. You know, that's beneath their pay grade. But take the TERF scene as a whole, and you'll find that the majority of what you read from them is brutal anon accounts saying brutal and hateful and vindictive and violent stuff about trans people. That's the bulk of what I see from the TERF space. And as someone who looks at a lot of fuckheads online, indeed I've made it my job, do you know what their brutal talk looks exactly like to me? It looks exactly like the brutal and vindictive discussions about trans people that I always see in neo-Nazi chat spaces on Telegram. In fact, it looks identical. There's an excellent long-form video by YouTuber ContraPoints called Gender Critical, which discusses TERFs. There you go. Now you've got a video reco as well if you need it. Newbies to this subject would do really well to have a look at that one if they want an easy ride into learning about this whole subject. ContraPoints dwells on the way that a lot of TERF discussion about trans people honestly just boils down to them going, ugh, yuck. Like, I just think trans people are gross, and they start from that core position, and then they cherry pick to build a rationale or a worldview that fits that core, ugh, yuck, reflex. That's very similar to what Nazis do. So to me, they're effectively the same. And given all that, it's definitely not my job to police how some of those transphobes should interact with others of those transphobes. In fact, that would be a complete waste of my precious time. So in the end, I just left Angela Jones on unread. I didn't even grace that bullshit with a reply. Because, like, why would I? What a fucking time waster. You know, every time that neo-Nazi stunts occur, I am asked how law enforcement and government officials should respond. Should we ban some more symbols? Do you think we should ban some tattoos, Tom? Do you think some tasers might fix this, perhaps? How about some laws, Tom? Would you like some more laws, Tom? Do you think ASIO might need a new spy plane for this, Tom? How about some raids, Tom? Would you like some more raids? There's a lot of public figures and groups who produce exclusively this kind of commentary, actually. Their job is to go, okay, we saw a neo-Nazi walking somewhere. Why don't we make more laws? It's time to ban some stuff. Time to give Mike Burgess a pay increase. Some of these people are in, like, NGOs or lobbying groups who compile reports for the government or for law enforcement on what ought to be done about extremism. You know, they might release a big annual PDF called the Global Extremism Report or something. I don't know. That sort of a vibe. There's lots of groups like that. There's figures like Davira Abramovich, who's the head of the Anti-Defamation Commission, and really it's his job to seek out media spots after every neo-Nazi incident to say, oh, let's make more laws, let's get more cops, let's get more spies, yada, yada, yada. And then there's a lot of media outlets who only ever really seek out those people for comment. So that, therefore, is what most of the public ever hears about this stuff afterwards. We've reached the point where all we hear after we see extremist stuff is a big national roundtable about how many new fucking laws and bans and cops we can pile on. We've had our imagination cut off by this fucking discourse so much that the thought of doing anything else about neo-Nazi nascent street formations doesn't even cross the Australian collective consciousness. First of all, I'm here to say that cops and governments either can't or won't do shit for this problem. Case in point, everyone's like, how could Victoria Police allow all that neo-Nazi sig hailing to happen on the steps? Why can't they send a strong message and arrest them? Where's the strong message? And since all that outcry, Vic Pol Top Brass came out and they go, oh, Nazis are bad, our job is so hard, oh no. But the truth is, bad Nazis making bad hand signs was not the priority of Vic Pol. It is not. And we all know that's not their priority. So why don't we just be honest about what Vic Pol is? They've been consistently overfunded by Daniel Andrews' Labor government for years, to the point that they've transformed into a highly weaponized paramilitary force. They are extraordinary robocops with immense power, and when a rally happens, they show up in combat armor with 80,000 police horses for three purposes. One is to demonstrate the strength of the state to all you peasants. Two is to guard against property damage, and three is to put down excessive displays of political will. They aren't there to promote community cohesion or whatever. They're there to take down anyone who gets too loud. And yes, I guess in saying that, the police or someone can raid the property of someone who's imminently planning a terrorist attack, and I can't. I suppose I've got to give them that. I hear it's illegal for me personally to do armed property raids. And also, you know what? In all honesty, I don't think I'd be very good at doing armed property raids, if I'm perfectly honest with you. I don't think that's my skill set. So that part's obviously helpful. But that's a very niche duty. And it's probably not one that required the entire port team to have been fitted out like Judge Dredd's. So the broader societal problem of neo-Nazism is not something that Vic Pol fixed by being stormtroopers. In fact, they probably alienate us peasants so much by doing that all the time that they might make it a bit worse. So that's cops, which leaves us with the government and more laws. I keep seeing all these calls for legalizing tattoos and gestures and symbols as like an imagined resolution to nascent neo-Nazi street formations. And I have to say, you all kind of make me sick. Like, I read all these people making a full-throated endorsement of this stuff. And remember, a lot of these people are like my friends or colleagues or comrades. I guess I'm not making any friends saying this, but I don't give a shit because this is not a me problem. This is a you problem. If this is your best idea on how to deal with fascists, then don't say more things at this time. Let's go through it. For one, history demonstrates that expanded legislative and police powers are used against everyone, and particularly against the radical left or progressives. Expanding laws will work against us before they do anything for us, and they certainly won't do anything to thwart a small pocket of violent fascist deadshits, okay? So that's one. Two, the NSN have lots of other little hand signs that they can do and little symbols they can use all their life. I assure you, neo-Nazis have no end of little magic spooky Hitler pictures to draw from. Banning these bad symbols will only lend more power to the new ones. In fact, you know that's true because the attendant media hype around the minutiae of far-right symbolism has already been played like a fiddle by them 100 fucking times over. Like, half of you practically gave them this as a hand sign for free, so you won't be able to help yourselves with the next dumb shit these losers do. Thirdly, the NSN will be able to legally contest some of these new laws, and they've already said that they will. So if they do, that'll give them months or years of free publicity, and that will just work in their favor. I get that these suggestions are well intentioned, but they come from people who lack the vision to understand that it's possible to work together as a community until fascists all get fucked. People calling for more laws and bans and stuff, they don't know about the history of anti-fascism. They don't know what activists in the community can do together when they work together. I think these people kind of exist in a vacuum of atomized hopelessness, you know? So they're kind of desperately hoping that a new law will fix this problem because they don't really know what else would. What we need is a healthier, organized activist left. The pandemic fucked us from organizing in real life for a while. It threw a spanner in the works, but we need to get back to the street. And you need to rally your mates together and form collectives. And dare I say it, if you want to get involved in anti-fascism against groups like the NSN who martial arts train, you should also hit the gym and learn to fight, even in self-defense, you know? If we can all do that together, well, we already ruined the Patriot movement. We did, and that was fucking enormous. So I reckon we can also fuck up a comparatively tiny, if somewhat more rough and ready group of neo-Nazis, you know? Meanwhile, I'm sure that people will keep doxing them because, like, look at them. Does anything about them tell you that they don't like being doxed? I mean, nobody likes being doxed, but I hate the normie line that they're wearing masks because they're cowards. Like, no, they're not, you fucking Channel 7 cunt. They're wearing masks to protect their lives outside of their white supremacist activism from harassment and loss of employment and opportunity and the breakdown of their relationships when their mums and dads find out that they're Nazis. And that is understandable. And I respect the fact that they desire privacy, but I also don't like them. In fact, I don't just like them, I hate them. And I think they're very dangerous. So, you know, they're in the ring, they know what they're up for. And you know, in 2021, when they all got doxxed, they fucking scattered, mate. Heaps of them went to ground. And that's actually why there's only a few of them. And that's really helpful because the less of them there are, the less likely people are to get hurt. You see? And naturally, as they all know deep down, that's gonna happen again. And again and again and again. And they know it, and all their prospective little tiny white boy recruits know it, and that's why they don't get as many applications as they otherwise would. And, you know, that's why they all wear all these masks all the time, even in their private photos. Notice how they still wear masks, even though NSN have promised to blur their faces out. It's pretty funny, man, because they are scared of being doxxed. They might not be scared of a blue with you on the street because they train to fight each other a few times a week, but they are scared of their lives being ruined. Everyone is. I get it, you know. But, hey, in an activist sense, that fear is exploitable. Most importantly, there's actually just so many more of us than there is them that it's just not funny. There's a real inequity here. We just need to be all in the same space working together. If we can do that, well, an energized left in Melbourne is nothing to fuck with, trust me. They know it too. I don't mean to speak for that city because I'm not there all the time these days, but I have a vested interest in anti-fascism all over Australia. And I have a vested interest right now and always in the safety of my trans comrades. And so should you. People need to get together, and the good news is, I think last Saturday was a bit of a kick up the arse, so it looks like people are getting together a bit more again. Let's all do that. Let's go protect each other against scumbags. Cheers, everyone. Thank you for watching my lengthy, tontanicky YouTube video. Patreon.com/tontanicky if you want to support my work.